maybe you could talk about the privatization issue.
Well, I'll start off by talking about it in this particular way. You know, that issue has come up several times at this conference, in both peripheral and central kinds of ways. Abdullah's talk earlier this afternoon, which I was very much taken by, was in part about privatization issues or intellectual property issues in a particular local kind of circumstance, which was quite compelling to hear about. And when he asked the question, which I've written down in my notebook, you know, if we wake up history, what is history going to say? The implicit question behind that is who should have, as it were, intellectual ownership of that set of resources and therefore any authoritative control and so on here. It's a deeply disturbing question for which I don't have an answer. I see arguments, you know, both ways here. This issue is not going to go away. What is the Academy's proper position upon it? Standing up and jumping up and down 200 yards from our legislators saying, you've got to do something about that, you've got to fight Disney, you've got to open the commons again, that isn't going to do us any good at all. I think the first thing we have to do is to create a bridge, sort of quid pro quo, between what we do in the university and deliver a value to the community and public at large, and what we expect back in return in the way of a public commons. Now, there's a particular book that I recommend. It came out about 5 years ago, I think now, from Harvard University Press by Corinne McSherry. It's called Who Owns Intellectual Property? I recommend it because it asks a hard question. Before we complain about what Disney, et cetera, are doing to intellectual property laws, let's take a look in the mirror and see our complicity in that dilemma as a university system in this nation. What about the fact that increasingly we are being encouraged, whether by the state legislature or by our deans and provosts, to become entrepreneurial, particularly, for example, in the scientific realms where patent and other IP issues are increasingly coming into the purview of professors and so on. McSherry makes a historical argument, which I find quite disturbingly compelling in the sense that it leaves us no easy answer. Her argument is that if you look at what we understand to be fair use and public knowledge and the commons of knowledge historically, it was granted to us as academics in return for us giving our knowledge back to the public. So, for example, if you write for the New York Times, your article is owned by the New York Times. You're writing for hire, as they call it. Whereas we have this odd exception in the Academy. When I write a book, the royalties and the copyright go to me for some odd reason. My book does not belong to the University of California system, although they're claiming ownership of my course notes, of course. here. McSherry's argument is that in order to retain that exception, that privilege, we have to continue somehow to give back full measure to the public in a way that they recognize to be of value. We cannot completely buy into a system where we become entrepreneurs just like everyone else, because then we lose the moral high ground and everything else as well.
Well, this has been actually an issue at Cornell. We have a former dean of the faculty who, in fact, has started an online publication program of things that are, in fact, open copyright, and a strong encouragement for faculty members to retain copyright, you know, not to give up copyright on things that they write, but to retain it, but then basically to turn, in effect, to turn it over to the university, that is, not to control it. And in the social sciences, I think it's been more successful than in history, because historians tend to write books more than social scientists do, and the issue is for the social scientists and their articles, or the agricultural scientists. This particular dean of the faculty was a former, or was a professor of agricultural economics, and so he was particularly concerned about practical articles that had to do with agricultural, soil, you know, crop issues and so forth. And it has had some success. And I'm trying to remember the name of the press. There actually is a press name for, I think it's called Cornell First Universities Press or something like that. And anything that's there can be downloaded and printed out by anybody for free, or if they want a bound copy, they can actually order a bound copy and pay, I don't know, $20 for it or something like that. But it's nothing that copyright has been retained on. So, I mean, there is actually some attempt